is an Unspoiled Network podcast.
This is Unspoiled, covering the Dresden Files, Book 6, Blood Rites, Chapters 10, 11, and 12. In these chapters, guess who was holding that gun?
It's our old friend!
Aw, so good to see him again. And, turns out, Thomas isn't the only wraith that our dear friend Harry is going to have to deal with in this case that he's taken on. Surprise!
That was crazy.
Welcome to Unspoiled. I'm a rolling thunder, power and rain. I'm coming on like a hurricane. My lightning's flashing across the sky. You're only young, but you're gonna die. I won't take no prisoners, won't spare no lives. Nobody's putting up a fight. I got my bill, I'm gonna take you to hell. I'm gonna get ya, see ya, get ya, a hell's bell. Yeah, so what'd you think of these three?
This was some stuff, man. Some stuff happened.
A lot going on, right? I had forgotten how packed these three chapters are because they each take on a whole different part of the story.
Mm-hmm. First it's Kincaid.
Kincaid and Harry talking about taking down Mavra.
Mm-hmm. Then we have...
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, then we have Murphy.
Mm-hmm.
And then finally he gets back to the set and we meet both Trixie and is it Lara?
Lara, yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, and when he talks to Murphy, you would think he'd be talking about Mavra too. But it's just a brief thing about trying to get information for the Alonzo case.
Mm-hmm.
And then they start talking about personal stuff.
Yeah.
So,
and we do kind of a deep dive into Murphy's whole situation,
yeah,
and her relationship with her mother and her sister, which we didn't get any of in any of the other books,
right? Yeah,
I mean, the only tidbit we knew about Murphy was that she had been divorced twice,
yep,
and that's pretty much all we knew about her personal life,
which is like a crazy thing to remember,
mm-hmm.
You know, it's just such a weird little. Because she just seems like somebody who would never have been in a relationship at all.
Right.
That meant anything because she's so, what's the word I want? Like, shut off in some ways?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I realized I said the Alonzo case, but I meant Arturo. Before everybody sends me a fucking email, I realized my mistake. Calm down. okay, so let's talk about... Now I forgot his name.
Kincaid?
Am I having a fucking stroke? Thank you. I was about to say McCain.
Oh, my God.
Can you even imagine?
Nothing would even get done. He would say a bunch of shit, but he would never do anything.
Trenchant.
Commentary.
So Harry gets jumped on the way into his apartment. He gets made to put on a mask over his eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody draws a circle in salt around him and activates it with blood. And then, surprise, it's Kincaid.
Yeah. This person clearly knows what they're doing. Has a very dry humor about the whole thing.
I love it so much.
I enjoyed it tremendously. Harry, because, you know, Harry is Harry, and he can't help but be a smartass, but that gun pressed up against the back of his neck is helping him kind of resist going 100% smartass. And whoever this is holding the gun is just almost bored by the whole thing.
Yes. That is an accurate assessment.
And I, you know, couldn't figure out who, you know, had no idea who was going to be holding the gun. And it takes a couple of maybe like two pages before we finally get to see, you know, who it is. And I was delighted.
and I, oh, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, I'm here to talk business, not die of stupidity. If you like, think of the precautions as a compliment. And Harry says, oh, because nothing says flattery like a gun to the head. And Kincaid says, ain't that God's own truth? That response is classic. I love it.
Yeah, it's good stuff. There's a, what does he say? Something like, oh, Kincaid's like, okay, so now we'll have a nice talk. And Harry's like, but why you're pointing a gun at me?
Mm-hmm.
And basically Harry's like, I would never do that. You know, I would never hurt you. He's like, no, that's not what the White Council says.
Yeah, he says, I don't want anybody's brain being redecorated mm-hmm. with magic. So he's worried that Harry's going to, like, mind control
him. Mm-hmm.
And Harry says, I can't do that, as if, like, well, the rules say, right. So I'm not able. And Kincaid's like, you can't get caught doing that.
Right.
Shut up.
That's, there's a fine line. But yeah, so this is a really, so basically, Harry has kind of wanted to see Kincaid.
Mm-hmm.
So he was kind of invited.
Yeah.
You know, it's not that he just popped up out of nowhere. And Harry is looking for muscle because he's still on his whole, I'm just going to go find the Black Court where they sleep and just fuck them up.
Yep.
And he's recruiting his little army.
Mm-hmm.
And Kincaid is down, but it's going to cost money. And he's not 100% sure Harry's going to pay him. And he has to make it very clear what happens if Harry doesn't pay him.
Yeah, what'd you think about this?
I thought that Harry better go get a loan.
You know?
How was his credit?
I'm going to guess it's worse than ours, considering that he can't even use electronics. There's probably, like, no trail. And he's got this, like, shady boarding house room in a basement somewhere that probably does not speak well for
right?
him.
Right? His name's probably not even on the lease. He's subletting it from somebody right. that died 100 years ago.
Like, does he even have a bank account? I guess, probably.
I can't remember if he takes checks or not. I feel like everybody always pays him in cash.
Yeah. I get, like, he probably does, but...
He just goes to check cash and please, like I used to have to do.
Pays 25% interest.
Yep. Then I love the thing at the end, too, because Harry is like, so what are you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I saw you at the fight at the ballpark.
Right.
And I saw what you did, you know. You took out however many people it was while you were moving. You never even missed a single shot. Like, what's up?
Yeah.
And Kincaid is saying, I'm just a regular... What does he say? I'm just
vanilla
plain folk.
Mortal.
I'm just plain folk.
Just plain folks miss sometimes. Maybe most times. You didn't miss once. What's the point of shooting if you're just going to miss? I'm as human as you are, Dresden.
See, that line right there, though.
Hmm?
There's something about this line. I'm as human as you are. That says to me, I'm supposed to be wondering. And I think I had wondered this about Dresden a book or two ago. Or I'm not 100% sure that he is 100% human.
Oh, yeah?
I'm not. I don't have a lot of hard facts.
Or, like, any. But, you know, whatever.
But I have a strong suspicion. And this little throwaway line, I feel like, is Jim Butcher trying to make me think that I'm thinking something that might be right. But it could also be a trap. He could be misleading me on purpose.
Well.
So I don't know. But
I guess we'll never know.
For right now, I feel like this is a line that I'm going to later be like, aha! So
everybody, I'm sorry I keep clearing my throat. I'm getting over a cold and talking jostles everything loose and makes me sound very sexual.
That is unpleasant. I want you to take it back. Jostling things in your throat.
So the thing that I like about this little conversation is how Harry's like, aren't you worried about my death curse? Oh, and Kincaid's like, your death curse? I'm going to be like 2 miles away. I'm going to use a sniper. You won't even know what happened.
Right.
And he says Harry's like, ooh, I don't like this at all.
Right. He says something like, the bullet is going to go faster than the sound. Mm-hmm. You won't even hear it coming.
Yep.
And the way he delivers it is so, like, matter of fact.
Yeah.
And Harry's just like, you know what? I think he has got a point. I would be dead before I had a chance to even say a word.
Yep.
And then he starts to talk about how behind the times this whole magical world can be sometimes.
At least he acknowledges it, unlike Harry Potter.
No shit.
They always try and be like, well, you know, magic. And I'm like, yeah, but, you know, ballpoint pens. Simple shit, you know? But yeah, I really enjoy Kincaid keeping up with all of that shit and being a threat. Not in that, like, he has it out for Harry at all, but if he wanted to do something, he's, as Harry puts it, is so much more practical about
mm-hmm,
it.
Mm-hmm.
He's not, like, fueled by revenge or greed or hatred or anything that could necessarily cloud his judgment. It's just about getting it done, and he doesn't need to be personal because he doesn't want to enjoy it.
Right.
He just needs to make sure that he does it so people know not to fuck with him.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, like, way scarier.
Yeah, I think so. It's a little like Marcone.
Yeah, that's true.
Sort of, you know, I mean, Marcone is a little bit more emotional, we found out, at the end of the last book, with certain things. But business-wise, you know, he's clear-headed and thinks, mm-hmm. you know, two or three steps ahead and, you know, is a man of his word and does things not because he necessarily wants to just go around doing it, but because you got to let people know you can't fuck with me.
Mm-hmm.
And then Kincaid is like, well, whenever we do this, I have to make sure I'm back home by such and such time.
I love that so much that he's taken this job, but like, let there be no illusions about who actually is the important
player. Right. Like who I really work for.
Mm-hmm. And she's just, she doesn't stand for it.
Yeah.
yeah, I love that. So he winds up leaving, and Harry thinks about how, as you put it, the magical world is behind on this shit. And then he thinks about how his worry and tensions slowly grew, and that he took a perverse comfort in the familiar emotions.
Mm-hmm.
It actually felt good to feel my survival instincts put me on guard against premature mortality. Hell's bells. Is that insane or what?
It is insane.
It is a little bit. That's and, not healthy guy.
Right. I love the change in Harry that we're seeing from the first book to this book, where this has become so routine. That mm-hmm. his life is in mortal danger and that there are forces of evil conspiring and all that shit that, you know, he has to fucking save the world again, like Buffy, you know? and that this is becoming his normal now, you know? Yep. These circumstances are where he's most comfortable anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Which is really fucked.
Yeah, it is.
You know, these are supposed to be exceptions. These, you know, this isn't supposed to be his life every day. And it's worrying because I don't feel like we have like 10 books left to read. I feel like it just gets so much worse. You know, there's not going to suddenly be a break and there won't be any more danger because then there wouldn't be so many books.
That's true.
There's clearly more danger coming. And so I'm a little bit worried for him.
Well, good. Okay, next chapter. So he tries to find out some information about Arturo, and everybody that he calls is like, check the internet. And he's like, thanks for fucking nothing.
This gave me this first paragraph. I laughed so fucking hard. I laughed so hard. First of all, he's like, everyone I talk to referred me to their homepage on the internet. evidently conversation with an actual human being had become passé. And then it just says stupid internet. I laughed so hard at that.
Oh God, now I'm choking.
It was a very Homer Simpson kind of thing. That's how I read it.
Stupid internet. Yeah. Yeah, Harry's an old man. In a lot of ways. Like, he doesn't keep up with technology.
No, he does not.
And it manifests itself like this.
Right.
Like, honestly, you know, he's like, well, why can't you just talk to a person? And everybody who's, like, age 35 and younger is like, thank God I didn't have to talk to a person. Oh, good. It's right here. I don't have to ask anybody. I'm so happy right now.
I love the idea that he wrote down some internet addresses.
Yes.
Which is so weird because, like, you don't need to know the address anymore.
Oh, my God. Can I just tell you, you don't watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine, do you?
Not very often.
There's an episode where Captain Holt is asking somebody about something that he read online. And he's like, I found it at womansdays.com/fitness/archives. Cakes and ampersand equals sign ISCH ampersand TBO equals sign 12674/2489. Do you know that site? And he reads them the entire fucking thing. It takes like a full minute for him to finish it. And they're just sitting there like, oh my God, what are you doing? And that is the kind of shit that I think Harry would do. He would write down the whole thing if he didn't short the computer out before he sat down. But he wouldn't know. And so he'd see this address and be like, seriously? And he'd write all of it out. And everybody'd just be like, what is this? I don't need all this. How should I know? Where are the instructions? So that's why he winds up going to see Murphy, because she can look this stuff up for him. And it turns out that she is not keeping as close an eye on this little puppy.
Oh my God.
As she said she would.
He walks.
You were like, she's definitely keeping this dog. But he comes and like takes this dog back right here.
Yeah, I was surprised because I thought for sure, who gives a puppy back? I thought for sure she'd keep it.
What kind of monster?
I mean, plus he's already got Mister, and I don't know. I just thought for sure, I was 100% sure she was going to keep that dog. But he scoops the puppy up and wants to go talk to Karen, and the guy, Stallings, is just like, she's in a mood.
Yeah.
Harry was like, well, just call her up. And he's like, nah. You call her up. And he turns the phone around to give it to Harry.
Nah.
Oh, shit.
That does summarize what he was like. He says, I plan on retiring.
And she is in a mood, though.
Mm-hmm.
She screams from inside. You know, I said, not now.
Yeah.
And,
she's not playing.
I like Harry. He's like, oh, it's Harry. And she's like that's, she's going to go, oh, you know, well, for you,
yes,
my mood will suddenly improve. And it gets worse.
Yeah. Then she's like, well, fucking stay away from the fucking door. You're going to fuck my fucking computer up. Fuck. Except without the fucks, but they were implied fucks.
They were definitely implied. So she is really pissy, and I like this too, because she's like, oh, it's paperwork, it's job, it's blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. But he's like, he's saying like in his head how he's seen her be in a lot of different moods, mm-hmm, you know? But this mood she's in right now isn't her.
Right.
This is, and he hasn't seen her this upset since she was dealing with the monster thing that happened to her in a couple books ago.
Mm-hmm.
So Harry's concerned, like genuinely concerned.
Right.
And he has to kind of coax her to tell him what's going on. And it takes, you know, a couple tries.
Yeah, it takes a couple tries because they haven't had this kind of conversation with each other before. Mm-hmm. and Murphy is resistant to emotional connection. Right.
Like, I don't think they've had a conversation like this since when we found out about the divorces at her house that one night.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, but I forgot about that. But that's it. Like, she does, you're right, she doesn't do this type of emotional work, you know, with anyone that we know of.
Yeah.
But she breaks down and she tells him, or she tries to tell him. He doesn't know what the fuck she's talking about. He cannot relate to this at all.
Nope.
As a man, as someone who doesn't have a family dynamic like this, he's just out of his depth.
Yeah, it's kind of amusing how she just says it, thinking that he's going to cotton on to what she's trying to, like, get across here.
Mm-hmm.
And he just keeps on being like, oh. And just sort of, like, waiting for her to just explain it a little.
Yeah, place. Oh, right. God.
Like, he's trying to be a good friend and listen, but he just does not have anything to offer.
He doesn't. He doesn't. At one point, he's like, well, I'm sure whoever you're dating is fine. And I feel like she wanted to be like, dude, what the fuck are you talking about? Who am I dating? Yep. How do you not realize I'm not dating anyone?
Yep.
And so she's concerned because she has a younger sister who has announced an engagement.
Mm-hmm.
And she's, as we've already mentioned, twice divorced. She has a relationship with her mom that is growing more and more distant between the divorces, which her mom didn't agree with the second one, the work that Murphy does, the things that are going on in her life now because of Harry that she absolutely can't talk to her mom about.
Right.
There's all this, like, space between them that didn't used to be there.
Yeah.
And it's, like, bumming her out.
Mm-hmm. I liked that detail, too, because if you are somebody who had a good relationship with your mom and all of a sudden there's this whole category of stuff mm-hmm. that you can't tell her about,
mm-hmm.
it does mess your brain up a little bit because yeah. you have the one person that you always went to when you needed to talk,
mm-hmm.
and now they're just off the table completely. Yeah. And it restricts the number of people that you can talk to about a traumatic event to the people who were also involved in the traumatic event,
which right.
they have their own baggage. And so yeah. you don't necessarily want to talk to them about it.
Yep. And yeah. you can't go to the same well that you've been going to for comfort. And the other person generally can pick up when someone is withholding from them, mm-hmm. you know, and then mm-hmm. that makes them feel weird and then they start acting weird and the whole thing just sort of compounds.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I was really sad listening to Karen talk about how her relationship with her mom has deteriorated. And then she tells a part that I thought was really surprising was that she had always thought she would be like her mom. Like, yeah. she admits that this life that she has now isn't even the life that she expected for herself.
Mm-hmm.
Which, is really kind of brave to admit that, mm-hmm. you know. It's one thing to talk about, oh, our relationship is suffered because of all these other things that have happened. But to be like, yeah, this life that I have isn't what she thought I would have. It's not what I thought I'd have.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't know what to do with that now.
Mm-hmm.
It was, yeah.
And her mom straight up doesn't approve of what she does either.
Mm-hmm.
Which that's a whole other layer of stuff.
Right.
Yeah, I like that too, because, like, I think that's something that we take on, like, unconsciously or not, a lot of, not just women, like, just in general, we have parents, and if they are a sort of, like, the head of the family in any sort of way, you sort of think, like, okay, well, eventually I'll do something like this or contribute to that in
mm-hmm,
some way.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized, like, a couple years ago that I always think of myself as that I will take that the role on that my grandmother had for our family, but I don't want kids. And I don't like the rest of my family and don't want to see them ever, really. Except for my dad's side, who are cool, and my mom and, like, her one sister, and the rest can just kind of kick rocks. So I have had this, like, this faithful idea that eventually I'll, you know, ascend to matriarch of this part of the, and it's like, but that's not compatible with literally anything that I actually want.
Right.
But I just sort of assumed. Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of where it is for Karen, is like, she's realizing that isn't even necessarily what I want, but I just thought.
Right, right.
You know, which I just really identified with that a lot. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh yeah. So yeah, that conversation with the two of them, I really like. And the, also the fact that her family is Irish Catholic and she has two divorces.
Mm-hmm.
So mm-hmm. not only does she not have a boyfriend, she's not engaged, she doesn't have a husband, but she's flouted their traditions.
Yep. Yep. Twice.
Yeah.
Yeah, and so, Harry tries to, the best advice he can give her, or really the only advice he can give her, as someone who's who doesn't have family, who knows what it's like to lose your family, is just that she needs to try to talk to her mom and make it right. Mm-hmm. Because you don't have forever. People don't stay mm-hmm. around forever. And that's usually the, like the thing, the last thing you want to hear when you're going through something like this mm-hmm. with your family members. I mean, it's probably the last thing you want to hear, the thing you most need to hear, and also like the least helpful thing to hear.
Indeed.
It's like all of those things at once. Because you know the person who's telling you this is right. I mean, you already know your family's not going to be there forever.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes you have to have someone tell you that.
Yeah, and it can feel a little bit like, well, at least you have a family.
Yeah.
To be upset, you know, right? And like, be like, really?
But, yeah, and it's not helpful. It's not helping you solve whatever the problem was that existed that made you not want to deal with your family.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just sort of stating a fact, which, again, is not always super helpful.
Right, yeah.
But it's one of those things, too, that, like, you have to be reminded of sometimes, because I think we always, even though we know intellectually you don't have forever, we don't really take that information in and act accordingly.
Definitely not.
You know, because nobody lives their whole every minute of their life fully aware of the, their mm-hmm. mortality and everyone else's. That would be a horrible way to live every moment of your life.
Right.
You know? Yeah. I mean, I know that's a horrible way to live. So you do need someone to say it sometimes.
Yeah, I appreciate, like, as somebody who lost their father and suddenly had it thrown into sharp relief, and then lost their grandma a month later, it really, you cannot overstate it, and yet you know, mm-hmm. as you say it, nobody's really going to get it until yeah. it's just too late,
because yeah.
that's how it works.
That's exactly how it works.
It's like my mom telling me when I was young to enjoy it now, sweetie, because mm-hmm. someday, and I didn't get it. Of course yeah. I didn't, because how can you? But
some things you can only get in hindsight. It just mm-hmm. it just sucks, but that's just the fucking rule of the universe.
Yep.
It's a fucked up rule of the universe.
Yeah, everyone listening, if you haven't gone through a family loss, like a really serious, close to your heart family loss, or even friend loss, do yourself a favor and go and ask them about their lives and like film it or take it a recording of it and interview them and fucking get it on the record. You will be so glad you did. I wish so much that I had asked my dad about some of the bananas shit that happened in his life. And when I say bananas, many people might think that it, I just mean crazy. But my father, in fact, worked on a banana plantation. So, it's accurate in many ways. But yeah, it's you don't realize how much you don't know about somebody's life.
That's
until they
true.
Die, and then people are giving eulogies, talking about shit that they did, and you're like, true. What?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, get on that, guys. Seriously.
I second that advice, guys. So... all right, enough of that.
So we agree with Harry, is what we're saying.
Yeah, as much as it pains us. Meanwhile, he's been holding this puppy in his arms this whole time, which I think is just really adorable.
Yes. Yeah, and he brings the puppy with him to the set, which is where he heads next.
He talks to the puppy, too. He's like, he has this theory. He calls it familial dementia.
Yes.
And he's like, you know, it's just a theory.
I love him chatting with this
like,
puppy.
My theory is just theoretical.
You don't say, sir.
to the set.
And he also, like, because he says to Murphy, I'm sorry if this added to it, the puppy. And she says, oh, no. He hardly made any sound at all. It was quiet as a mouse. And I was like, he was? Puppy? Okay.
Yeah, that is weird for a puppy, isn't it?
Puppies that I have known, mm-hmm. I'll just say, were not. But, yeah. So he heads to the set and is greeted by a girl that he hadn't met in like earlier when he was there that morning, named Inari, who is just about 18, mm-hmm. as we find out.
Yeah.
She's just turned the legal age to perform if she likes.
Right. And he goes through great pains, great pains to describe her.
Listen, there is a lot of ogling of women in this particular chapter.
There, and it's weird because he can't make up his mind to ogle this girl or not. It's mm-hmm. like she's familiar. She wasn't old enough to drink, but she was very perky. She was pretty, but she was more awkward. You know, it was, he's mm-hmm. just like, yeah, it's good, but it's not. But then it's good again, but then it's not. It's very weird.
I think that's the thing that I get the most uncomfortable with is when Butcher seems to try and be like, listen, I realize that this girl that I'm describing is really young and I shouldn't ogle her, but also I kind of want to. So I'm going to sort of.
Yeah, it's a very kind of clunky, this description of her. It feels like I think it's a good observation. It feels like he's uncomfortably describing her. Like he, mm-hmm. you know, he's not really sure. It's a very different way than, and I don't mean the description, but just the way he writes it when he goes to describe Trixie in a minute.
Right.
You know, that is full on comfortable with what I'm writing. And right. I'm just going to go to town on it, you know?
Yep. Go to town on it. Pun intended. So this girl, Inari, is she is an associate gopher, as she says it. She's down the ladder from him, so he doesn't have to worry about his job. And she wants to know what he wants on his vegetarian pizza.
And he wants meat.
He wants meat on that vegetarian pizza, please, which I can relate to.
Right. I like also that she keeps trying to, like talk to him as though he's agreed to have a vegetarian pizza.
Right.
And he keeps being like, no.
I feel like we've covered this already, but apparently I
Right? And she's like, well, what do you want? I'm supposed to make you happy. And he's like, well, then kill me some animals then. And this goes on for a little while, and then she's like, well, Arturo wants to see you immediately, like, as soon as you get here.
Before we move on from this pizza thing, I am so confused by it. Can I read you this thing?
Okay.
She says, everyone decided they wanted to stick with veggies when I order. If someone has meat, the grease will get all over the rest of the pizza, so they settle on veggies. And he says, then I guess I will too. And she says, but what do you want on yours? That's not, what do you want on yours? You're talking like it's all one pizza. So what, does everybody's slice get different toppings? What fucking pizza place is accepting that kind of order? That's nutty. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I guess I do. I guess I thought that, well, yeah, it doesn't make any sense.
Mm-mm.
I just figured it was like a half and half pizza, but she's saying everybody gets their own shit on it. It doesn't make any sense at all.
Yeah.
Maybe she's going to get, I don't know. Maybe she's ordering everybody's slices. Maybe it's not a big pizza. Maybe they're ordered by the slice and then
Then why would the grease get on the rest of the pizza?
Maybe they just put them all in a big thing to make it easy to carry. Look, I don't know.
I'm just saying, I appreciate that you seem as bewildered as I do, because I read that a few times and was just like, this isn't what? Because trust me to fixate on the only part of the book so far where food is really like mentioned in any detail. But I don't approve of this whole thing. It just doesn't make any sense. Anyway, moving on. Okay. So she promises him that he can have real Coca-Cola. And then he goes to see Arturo, who is really fucked up about the fact that this girl almost died.
Yeah.
If Harry wasn't there.
He is in a state. He's ready to call the whole thing off. You know, he's got these people and he feels like he's putting their physical well-being at risk, which he kind of is.
True.
And the scars are going to be very bad on poor Gazelle. Or Giselle. I forget what we decided on.
You keep calling her Gazelle like she's some sort of
like an animal. Antelope. Aren't they very graceful gazelles?
Yes.
That's like kind of what their thing is,
and they're
right?
Fast. Yeah.
Yeah, gazelle.
Okay, as long as we get that settled.
So, he has a talk with Harry. He basically almost, like, what does Harry think? What do you think I should do?
Mm-hmm.
And surprisingly, Harry gives him what I thought was really good advice.
Yeah, he does. And Arturo is also surprised. For a young man, you have good judgment. But yeah, Harry's basically like, well, you've got to decide what you want to be. Do you want to protect them or do you want to lead them? And if you protect them, then that's what you're picking and you have to stop. But you're also, if you do that, letting somebody dictate your life. So is it worth it, or do you want to take the risk and prove that people don't get to bully you into dropping your dream? And he decides that he will tell everyone that no hard feelings if they want to leave the project, but that he is going to stick with it. Which... I like that.
Yeah, I do too.
I think that's a good method. It's kind of a compromise, you know.
Well, yeah, it is. One of the things that Harry says is, or that Arturo says is that I can't decide for them whether their life is worth it or not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I can decide for myself. So, yeah, I'm going to stay and I'm going to make this movie. But, you know, we have to give them the choice.
Right.
Which we don't see. I guess that'll come up next. I'm curious if anybody will leave.
Yeah.
I wonder if that Bobby kid, was his name Bobby or Billy? Bobby.
Bobby, yeah.
I bet
the Bowflex dude.
Yeah, I bet he leaves.
Yeah? Why do you say that?
I don't know. He seems like a shit.
The fuckboy's going to bail.
You know, I mean, unless he wants to try to prove, you know, if he still feels like he has something to prove, he might stay for that. But let's see, the girl that they were talking to outside the studio, that went to eat with Bobby. I can't remember her name. The one that's got a kid.
Right. I don't remember her name right off the top of my head either.
She stays.
Okay.
Which I think will be weird because she has a kid, right? So you would think that maybe she would think, well, this isn't worth it. But I also feel like her situation is desperate enough that she's going to stay.
Okay, gotcha.
So after he's done, they come to this decision, Harry and Arturo talking about, you know, Harry feels like there's something more to the story. He calls it something's hinky.
Yeah.
I thought it was cute that Arturo doesn't recognize it. And Harry's like, it's a Chicago word. I'm like, no, it's not. But
isn't it?
Says, no. Is it?
I thought it was. The only other place that I've heard it was in The Fugitive.
Really?
And that's based in Chicago.
Oh, no, I've heard it.
Let's see. I'm trying to find...
Maybe it is a Chicago word. I didn't realize that. I mean, I've heard... Maybe that's where it comes from.
Possibly from obsolete Scots hink, from Old Norse hinka, to limp or hobble. Probably not from Old English... thanks for nothing. This is not telling me anything. What? It's saying, okay, acting suspicious, strange, unusual, shady, sketchy, dishonest, non-standard, unreliable, and then the sixth usage, snobbish or haughty.
Oh, no, I've never heard it used that way. Yeah, me either.
Nah.
Interesting. So Harry's like, I think it might be something a little bit more personal. This doesn't seem like a business move to, you know, involve this type of magic. And they're like, you know, brainstorming. Mm-hmm. And they get someone burst in.
How about this?
This chick.
This bitch. Her original name, which she changed for obvious reasons.
No kidding.
Was Trisha Scrump.
That is unfortunate.
That's hilarious. Scrump. Anyone listening whose last name is Scrump, my condolences, but I will not apologize for making fun of this name. And you must understand this, I'm sure. But this bitch is very insecure.
Yeah.
She does not like that Arturo has brought on another woman.
Yeah.
Who is supposed to be retired. And it becomes quite clear very quickly why she doesn't want this other woman there, because yeah, she is everything that Trisha is not.
Yeah. Trisha is, I want to say trying too hard, but she's dressed for work, so maybe I can't blame her for that. But, you know, he calls her a living goddess of a woman. Mm-hmm. You know, she's big boobs, big ass, you know, blonde, high heels, you know, everything.
Yep.
She's everything that you think you're going to see on a porn set. And she's like, didn't I ask you to get me a latte an hour ago to Harry, who wasn't there an hour ago? I love that.
Bless him.
he's just
like, oh, right. Yeah, sorry.
Yeah. He's like, I thought about saying something, but Arturo looks at him like, oh, my God, please don't. Please don't.
Yeah. I love that. Mm-hmm. That Arturo's just like, he like winces mm-hmm. when she comes in, like screaming at him. And he calls her Trish twice.
Yeah. She's not amused.
She doesn't like
it. Not at all. and she's just like, she's just fucking making a whole scene.
Yep.
And right when she's about to like leave, like exit stage left after this big thing she did,
mm-hmm.
someone else is at the door.
Surprise!
And he describes this woman, like, in comparison to Trixie. First of all, he says it makes her look like the ugly stepsister.
Mm-hmm.
And this woman is everything that Trixie isn't.
I really like, he says, her body was, like, no more important than a glass is to wine.
Mm-hmm. That's very nice.
I like that, like, in concept, but he then is like, because you can see the spirit within, and I'm like, you don't know her. What are you talking about? But, yeah, I reserve judgment on that a little bit, because I got what he was trying to do here, but also mm-hmm. I was sort of like, But, yeah, this woman, he describes Trixie as looking like she had checked every box on the hot girl, like, paint-by-numbers kit. And had been put together from a kit.
Mm-hmm.
But that this woman looked like she was a piece of art. And yet he doesn't really remember what her face looked like.
Mm-hmm.
Or her body. He just knew that she was like perfect.
Right, yeah. He says she was grace.
Yep.
And he describes her, even though he can't remember what she looks like.
Mm-hmm. He describes what she's wearing in detail. Yeah,
her hair and her eyes and then her clothes.
Right.
And she's fully dressed in what he calls an effortless style compared to Trixie, who is walking around in lingerie.
Mm-hmm.
And this woman is just, well, he goes quite on. She is beyond mere physical presence.
Right.
But she seems like a very nice woman, though.
Yeah, I mean, and she definitely, like, knows the kind of intimidation she has mm-hmm. over Trixie.
Oh, she's got her number 100%.
It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
This is the kind of petty shit I would do if I had that kind of power. And this woman was, like, as insufferable as Trixie clearly is.
And so Trixie is, like, trying to insinuate that... Well, she's not insinuating. She comes out and says it. That Lara basically does, like, bondage porn mm-hmm. and is somehow beneath her. Mm-hmm. And she says, you know, I'm surprised to see you here. And then Lara's like, bondage is, which is I've always felt the best whips and chains are in the mind.
Yeah, I like that line a lot. One hardly needs them if one's doing it right. I'm like, girl, kind of want to meet you, though.
And then she's and, like, have you given any more thought to my offer to Trixie?
Trixie's just like, no, I don't do bondage films. And she says they're for wrinkled old has-beens.
Oh, my God.
Which, like, how you can say that to a woman who looks like Lara with a straight face, mm-hmm. really. Yeah, that's one of those things that the ability to, like, insult somebody in a way that is so clearly untrue mm-hmm. to anyone in the room, that's always been something that fascinates me, because it's like you have to be willing to make a fool out of yourself to claim something like that and have everyone in the room know that you are so insecure that you're just going to lie.
Yeah.
Boldly yeah. lie. And that just makes you look bad. Mm-hmm. But I guess it's not about the other people in the room. It's about her, like, wanting to make Lara feel insecure, which clearly doesn't work. Yeah,
exactly. She's, like, trying to be insulting to someone who, like, can't be insulted by you.
Yeah.
But, you know, people are usually the last to know that they don't have a leg to stand on to insult someone else.
That's true.
Because my guess is that age-wise, Lara is probably much older than Trisha. Like, just by the numbers.
Probably.
So that's all Trisha feels like she needs, you know? Like, that's mm-hmm. enough. And even though the reality is that, you know, Lara is still apparently gorgeous. Mm-hmm. But Trisha's like, well, it doesn't matter. You're 30 now, so you're old.
That's like 50 in bunny years.
Right? That sounds like something she would say.
Like, I know, like, she has to be older than Trish by a substantial amount if she's a Wraith, right? Like, I'm not even sure that Trixie necessarily knows a real age on her.
Yeah, I mean, I was just thinking for Trisha, thinking that I'm assuming she just thinks Lara's just, you know, human. Mm-hmm. Lara's probably, she's got the sister that just turned, I figure she's probably in her, like, I figure like 30, 31. Okay. I don't know where exactly I got that from, but that just felt about right. I think part of me knows that Butcher's not going to have her be significantly older than that. Mm-hmm. That feels like a good juicy middle age for her to be.
Don't ever phrase it that way again, please.
Like, you. Right in the meaty, like, center of, like, you know, still young enough to be hot and attractive and sexually viable, but old enough to be respectable.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, thank you for calling me respectable. Thank you for talking about how I'm in the meaty center. You couldn't just leave juicy out. Nope. You had to then bring up the meaty center. Gross, you disgusting. So yeah, the whole thing is that Lara has agreed to do the shoot because of Giselle being injured. Mm-hmm. But she has agreed to a pseudonym and to wear a mask.
Right, because Missy Pants is so fucking insecure. And that's what caused her to come screaming into the office in the first place. Mm-hmm. So she's trying to do a solid for Arturo, who she seems to, you know, really be fond of. Mm-hmm. Now, she is not an ex-wife. Trixie's an ex-wife.
Yes.
What was the other woman, the producer's name?
Madge.
She's not an ex-wife, is she? Joan is an ex-wife.
Oh, Joan that's... Oh, no, yeah, she's not... Madge isn't a producer. She's an investor, I guess. And the producer, Joan, no, she's not an ex-wife.
So, but I know he has three?
Right. I think the other one is one that we haven't met.
We met one at the party, right?
That was Madge.
That's Madge.
It was her apartment.
Right. She's the, okay. And then Trixie's the second one. So yeah, I guess the third one we haven't met yet.
Yeah.
But it's not Lara.
No, it's not.
Oh, okay. All right.
You seem so, like, surprised by
that. Yeah, I thought we had met them, but that means there's still one out. Yeah. I wonder who that's going to be. What nonsense is she going to bring to the table?
So, yeah, you're right. She seems to be genuinely fond of him. And Harry notices, because Harry gets the biggest boner of all time when she walks into the room and cannot, like, focus to, like, the point that once she starts talking to Arturo, he then, like, kind of recovers and starts to, like, put up a mental barrier.
Mm-hmm.
But he notices that Arturo is not reacting to her the way that he reacted to her, and he cannot figure this out. What do you think of that?
I don't know. I don't know. I'll be honest, I didn't really think about it.
Okay.
I don't know. Maybe do they get used to them after a while?
I don't know. I'll reply with your own answer.
Because Harry, I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know, guys. Sorry.
That's fine. I just thought maybe you would notice.
I didn't.
Because, yeah, he, like, shakes her hand and gives her a hug and a kiss on each cheek and seems totally normal. And meanwhile, Harry's about to put a hole through the front of his pants. And it's just like, for fuck's sake, Jesus Christ. And they walk out together. And she, like, just glances over her shoulder at Harry. And he thinks that if she had just crooked her finger at him, he would have floated after her on a cloud of her perfume.
Like Peppy Hoopshoe.
Right.
They also talk about her little sister, who is the gopher.
Right.
And.
Because he calls her a child.
Yeah.
And Lyra's like, well, she could be in one of these movies now. And he's like horrified.
He looks horrified at that, right?
Which, you know what? I like that. I like that he's not being predatory. And like, yeah. Oh, I can't wait till she's of age. Am I right, boys?
Yeah,
like,
that's a nice fucking change, right?
Yeah. Appreciate it.
So yeah, you're right. They leave and that's when he starts putting things together.
Mm-hmm.
And it just hits him, you know. That
he's in the middle of a goddamn mess. In summary.
So yeah, he thinks that she's a wraith. And then he calls them he's like succubuses, succubuses, succubi.
I'm looking this up now to find out what the correct one is. Plural of succubus.
And then he's like, what does he say? That stupid Latin correspondence course.
Yes. Stupid internet. What is the correct plural form of succubus? Succubuses or bi?
Oh, either. Okay.
Yeah. It could be either one. So yeah, succubi seems to be the most used though.
Okay. So yeah. He's not sure about the younger sister. That kind of is, he's not sure exactly what's going on there because he says that he didn't have that kind of reaction to her.
Right. Yeah, so any theories on that?
I don't know. Maybe they hit, maybe until they actually hit a certain age, it's not a thing for them. Like their powers don't really manifest.
Yeah, that would make sense.
Maybe it could also be why he couldn't quite get a handle on whether she was attractive or not. Like maybe her signals are all mixed.
Hmm. Okay.
Yeah. But so I don't know if it's going to turn out to be just a coincidence that she's in there. You know, that she just happens to be a succubus.
She being Lara?
Lara, yeah.
Okay.
You know, that she just happened to fall into this work because, you know, it works for her.
Right.
Or if she's there because she seems to go back with Arturo, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if the trouble that's happening is because of her or it's just a coincidence that she happens to be in Arturo's life. I feel like part of me wants to be like, no, it's not a coincidence because that's not a good story. That's not a good way to tell a story. But I kind of almost like the idea that he has someone on his side that can help him with this, but he doesn't even know it. You know?
Okay. Yeah.
Like whatever this trouble is doesn't really have anything to do with her, but she's going to be an asset to him and he doesn't even know. Arturo, I mean, and then by extension, Harry. But it's probably more likely that whatever's going on, she has something to do with. Maybe someone is mad because of her continued involvement with him.
Hmm.
You know, that seems pretty straightforward.
Yeah, that's an interesting
some other question. Person that floated behind her on her cloud of perfume.
Right.
I'm assuming she has this sort of effect on a lot of different people. Maybe Harry had a reaction and Arturo didn't because she can control when it, I don't know. I don't know how the succubus works. But maybe somehow Harry being a wizard made him particularly susceptible to her. Yeah. Like maybe she's on the low and she keeps it like tamped down, you know, mm-hmm. when she's out and about in the world because she doesn't really want to live as a succubus. But Harry picks up on it because he's so perceptive.
Right.
I don't know, guys. I'm just throwing shit out there. I don't know. I'm tired. It's late. It's 11:30 my time.
Yeah. We talked for a bit, you know.
As is our way.
So that's basically it. The end of the chapter is Harry like realizing that he's in a nest of vipers and that he's going to punch Thomas in the nose because he seems to really believe that Thomas had to know
mm-hmm.
that Lara was part of this. Like,
yeah,
it doesn't really even enter his head that she's here without Thomas being aware of it. He's just like, fuck you, Thomas. Right. He seems very annoyed, which I feel him on that. Cause like, why not tell him? He's going to find out, mm-hmm. you know?
Well, she wasn't supposed to be on this movie, though.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. And the one thing that we didn't really talk about, because, you know, we were focusing on, like, the ex-wives and that whole thing, but Genosa talks about a the porn industry potentially not wanting him to finish the project because they have control over the production of everything and have been buying out studios and stuff. And that like they tried to buy out the studio that he's using now.
Right.
And Harry is just kind of like, wait, seriously? Like, it's a porn film. Like, who cares? And he's like, no, this is a big industry.
Yeah. And somebody is trying to kind of monopolize it. There's some mm-hmm. interest out there that's been spending a lot of money.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I mean, again, like Harry was like, it doesn't seem like it's a business thing, you know, but we saw Marcone right. Bring on someone to help him accomplish what he was trying to do as far as getting the shroud. So I don't know if we should be discounting the idea that a businessman could, you know, seek out someone to use magic on their behalf.
Right. Yeah, I mean, and it's like the magic thing, like it could be that. But what Harry seems to be preoccupied by is how vicious it's been that like it that he feels like if it were business, like the way that they're being attacked, that would feel more right. But it's been brutal is the word that he's used. Mm. So while he doesn't like completely discount it out of hand, he is just like, something's hanky.
Yeah.
You know? So yeah, I guess we'll find out. All right. So I'm just going to say, first of all, let me double check this. I don't think we have. Yeah, we don't have any new reviews, but I want to thank everybody who has left some because we're at 54. So that's pretty good for a fairly new show. And by new, I mean a year old. But, you know, with my track record, this is fresh and vibrant. And I want to let everybody know that I am taking it under advisement that perhaps, maybe, possibly, perhaps eventually, covering Doctor Who would be something people would be interested in. If this is something that you would like, please let me know. I posed the question on Facebook the other day, and it seems like people like the idea. I am concerned about letting everyone down in the case that I don't like the show. And it's so close to so many people's hearts. And what if I just don't? What if I just don't, guys? Then what? Do I just stop? Do I just say, I hate it too much, I'm sorry, I can't do this, and then just quit? I don't think I've ever done that with something that's like a finished property. Well, I guess it's not finished, but it's just gone on for so long, you know. I've only done that with shows that were like currently running and started to completely devolve into madness, like Scandal, which coincidentally is airing its final episode today. Mm-hmm. And The Walking Dead, which I am in good company because I've seen other shows have quit that show as well. So,
And Empire.
Oh, God. That's right. I forgot about Empire. Empire was one of those.
Everybody quit Empire, though, so
Lord, don't feel bad. What happened? That had been so much fun, too, for a minute. Fucking what's-his-face? Why'd they cast him? He's a mess. I hate his face and everything that he stands for and is.
Terrence Howard?
Yeah. I hate him. Ugh. We watched we were doing the Marvel Challenge and watching the old Marvel movies, and he's the fucking War Machine in the first Iron Man, mm-hmm. and I had, forgot that. And he's so, unpleasant. He's just off-putting. You know? There's just something,
There's something damp. Very creepy about him.
He's like a frog somehow. He just seems damp. He gives the impression of somebody who, he would have clammy hands, you know, if you shook his hand and probably if you were asleep in bed next to him and you reached over, he'd be all sweaty, but also cold, you know, that awful combo. Ugh. Ah, I don't like him. Very creepy man. Anyway, new patrons. Hi. So this week we've got JMW, Christina Connolly, Julia Amorosi, Anne Rinke, Jean-Marie Tomlin, Sherry Carol Mays, Julika Mee, and Simon Jeskolt. I don't know. I'm sorry I had to say your name, but your email is Wicked Woodpecker of the West, which is great. I love it. So welcome to the Wicked Woodpecker. I'm sorry I don't know how to say your actual name. But welcome to all of you guys. Thank you all so much for being patrons. And for those of you who don't know, I started a Discord channel for patrons recently. And it's great because it ties in with Patreon as long as you link them. It's not working for everybody, the linking thing, but we'll figure that out. But I think it's a nice alternative. A lot of people are trying to avoid Facebook lately, or they just don't have Facebook accounts, but they still want to be part of the community. And Patreon's awkward to navigate, and there's no way to make a community on Patreon very easily. So Discord has different channels in it, and we've got one for every show that is currently running. And there's a spoiler version and a spoiler-free version. And also we've got some other channels. There's the therapist's couch where we can go and talk about our mental health stuff. And there's politics and there's health and all this stuff. There's one for my wedding because I'm sharing with everybody what I'm going to be choosing for food and decorations and whatever. So if you are a patron and you want to be part of that, just let me either let me know and I can send you the link, or I posted the Discord link in a post about 3 days ago. What day is it? Is it the 18th? It's the 19th. I think I posted on this like 17th or 16th. So it's in there if you don't want to bother talking to me, which I understand. But it's also in the Patrons Only Facebook group, which is another thing. So if you'd like to join that and you didn't see the link, you can hit me up on Facebook for that. And if you would like to become a patron and get in on that shit, it's patreon.com/unspoiled. And you can pledge whatever you like, whatever your little heart desires, and become a part of like a really growing, it's crazy how big it's getting, group of people that are awesome and around a lot. So there's always conversations to be had and everybody's always sharing really funny, stupid memes or articles about things that we're covering. It's really fun. And also totally off topic stuff too, like I was saying. So yeah, I think that's about all I wanted to mention. And Rashawn and I recorded our first episode of the Unsobered bonus podcast, which I still have yet to edit. I've fallen very behind from being sick this past week. But I'm excited because I get to choose brand new theme music. Like everything else I cover, I have to choose a song that's to do with the material. But because Unsobered isn't to do with any particular subject, I could just pick a theme song. What theme? Like, Rashawn.
I don't know.
Should it be like jazzy? Like laid back, like, ooh, we're drinking wine at a wine bar. Or should it be like, oh God, do you like pina coladas? Or it could be like, Margaritaville.
No, it can't be that. It absolutely can't be that.
Or it could be, what would I be without my baby? I'm just kidding, I won't choose that one. It's tempting, but I won't. Out of respect for Mr. Rule. That's what I call him. Professor Rule, when I'm feeling really respectful. Yeah, I gotta pick. Or I could pick something dopey that's like, you know, like something really upbeat, almost like comic-y, like a cartoon. Because we're both like going to be like dopey and drunk.
Oh my God.
In future episodes. So I'll be
we'll have to give this some very serious thought because I don't like any of these suggestions.
Or I could pick like tuba music, like when you're like drunk and you're like walking really slow. Like, something like that. Yeah. Maybe I'll pick a different one every week. I won't do that. It's a pain. But yeah, I'd be interested in your input on that, Rashawn. So be ready for like a bunch of MP3 files to come at you tomorrow at some point. And you're going to hate them. All right, everybody. Well, we love you. We hope you are enjoying the show so far. If you are, please leave a review on iTunes because that super, super helps us. It's a great way to support a show that you get to listen to for free. And notice, there are no advertisements on my show, everyone. So, you know, help a girl out. Help a podcaster out. And leave us a review and tell people how much you love us and that they should also listen. And share it on iTunes, or share it, not on iTunes, on Facebook and on Twitter. And follow me on Instagram and on Facebook and on Twitter. Facebook.com/unspoiledpod, Twitter at unspoiled show, Instagram at unspoiled.
Almost.
So close. Almost. I'm so too close to the sun. Unspoiled podcast on Instagram. Hashtag unspoiled. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you next week with a new episode. Toodaloo, motherfucker.
Bye, guys. That just got away from you.
I got punchy at the end. I'm very ill.
Unspoiled Network Podcast.